The way you wear your hat, the way you sip your tea, the memory of all that again on the bumpy road to love. Still I'll always, always
know how you know you how you hold a wine glass. Do you know? How? Tell me.
Your knife, the way we dance till
I teach all this.
And now, broadcasting live, Madam Powell and Mr. Dinwiddie.
Motown U at NYU
is a series to celebrate the 50th anniversary of the founding of Motown Records. Tonight, I have the honor of introducing a lady who has played a major role in shaping Motown as we know it and love it.
And the minute someone tells you you can't do something, say under your breath, don't get an argument with them, because you're going to lose your cool, and you're just as ugly as they trying to tell them off. So don't allow anyone to put their garbage in your computer, because you should be throwing your own garbage out. Everybody is somebody, and you were born to master something. Don't forget that. Try not to die before you find out what you can master.
The Motown Mystique. Where did it come from? Marvin Gaye. The Temptations. Diana Ross and the Supremes. Stevie Wonder. They all had it. Have you ever heard of Maxine Powell? She's the lady who brought class, style, and refinement to Motown.
My parents and I and my daughter were driving down West Boulevard, and we happened to see Hitsville, and we said, gee, we've never been over to visit the museum. Let's go over there. And to our surprise, we saw this wonderful, lovely, unappreciated woman standing here who is part of history. And I said to myself, she is finally getting recognized for all the work and commitment that she has given Motown and Berry Gordy, and the recognition that she's brought to this city.
I had seen this lady on specials on TV, and I knew of the beginnings, and I knew they had coaches. These kids were from the inner city. They had to develop poise. The wonder of the music got all of us going nuts. I always knew that the civil rights movement would get ahead, but as far as I'm concerned, the integration of the white music and the black music and having white kids hear it was the beginning of it all. And you brought that music in the house, and my mother was tapping her foot. So it was magnificent.
Are you in town for a few days?
Till tomorrow night.
And you just, okay, and you went, is this your first time by the Motown Museum?
Yes, and I thought we'd see it, and it's closed.
And look, but look at who you met.
I can't believe it.
Isn't it fantastic?
I'm trying to tell you so that I can tell him why you're here.
Tell him?
Yeah, this is Professor
at NYU?
Yeah,
oh.
He is.
How do you do,
helping me write my book.
Oh, wonderful. And I'm going to buy your book.
Oh, well, we're glad to hear that.
Here with us, we have Mrs. Maxine Powell. She is a mastermind. She put these female groups together.
I had a finishing school in Detroit that no one, I'm from Chicago, that no one has equaled today. And I opened up in 1952, before there was a Motown. I closed my finishing school and opened a finishing school within Motown. And I said to my students, allow me to help you unmask and become and realize and discover what a beautiful flower you are.
So you've worked with Martha Reeves and the Vandellas?
I worked with Martha Reeves and the Vandellas.
Thank you. Detroit?
When I landed here in Detroit, I had $27,000, a lone black lady. I was separated from my husband. And then I dated a fellow, and he passed. So then he left me, he was wealthy, $10,000. So I had, I guess you could call, $27,000, $5,000, $10,000. So I always say I had colored people's money. So I had money to come in here and do things with.
So she came to Detroit in 1941. She remembers telling the story of the end of World War II. She was giving a manicure when kind of everything erupted and just everybody got excited and was out in the streets and stuff. And over the years, she had started to work with these different clubs. And the clubs were, for the most part, I mean, nightclubs and things like that, they were segregated. But she would go there and talk to the people, we want to have an event here, I work with this ladies group, and we'd like to have an event here. And they would say, we're sorry, we can't have colored people. And she would continue to go and go and talk and talk and negotiate until she got to the point where people would say, okay, you can come on such and such night. So she had a really important impact in Detroit in terms of desegregating a lot of places.
One of the things you had talked about with me before was what gave you the idea and made you decide to start the modeling school.
Well, because they couldn't model. There was no market for black models. I wanted to teach personal development and self-growth. That's why I said Maxine Powell finishing school. It was a gimmick. There was no market for no black models. Everybody came. Fat, you know, I advertised. I always believed in top. You know, Buckingham Palace and the White House. Some was attractive, some were pretty, some were beautiful. That was a matter of looks, physical beauty. Is desirable. But real beauty comes from within.
How were they responding to your saying all this?
Well, they were looking at me like I was out of space. And they'd already said that I was crazy, that all they wanted was a hit record. I had to see them perform before I could instruct them at all. Walk up and down for me and turn. Step up on that platform. Sing for me.
Do you remember any first impressions you had of them when you first, when they first performed? First impressions you had of, for instance, Smokey, the way he performed.
Well, I thought he was ridiculous laying down on the floor.
You used to lay down on the floor?
Well, yeah, did you ever see him perform? They don't lay down, but they bend down, they're down squatting down, just a-going. Yeah, I couldn't see his face. I couldn't see his eyes. Your eyes are the mirrors of your soul. And that's why when you close your eyes to sing, it's because you're insecure. And you've gone off in a world of your own. And I told them about correct posture, and that it was class to stand in the basic standing position and never lose that. Never bend the torso or shake the buttocks.
And Smokey and the Miracles listened to me. And they tried. And they tried all they could. And I said, and I didn't scold them.
That was their style at that particular time, and they were young. But I gave them the basic standing position, because someday
They would not lie down or squat down to perform.
And one of the first questions I asked Berry Gordy was, what about Maxine Powell?
And what did Berry Gordy tell you about Maxine Powell?
He told me that she made everything happen. She transformed these kids into adults. She transformed them into really beautiful, stunning, elegant people. And I just thought, what an incredible thing.
You see, I wanted to be funny. You know what I mean? I don't want a story pointing fingers and call a name. I want to show how to do something and tell the truth, and you can laugh about it and learn from it. That's my thing in life. See? And we don't have to keep working with it until it brings in some humor and tells a drastic story what's been done to a woman, a lone woman without a husband that reached out, and they're still doing it.
I'm responsible for making sure that she's remembered as she was. And so her legacy at Motown, her legacy in the things she created, the Maxine Powell finishing in modeling school, Maxine Powell training young ladies to have self-esteem and to develop who they were. These are the things that are really important to get across about Mrs. Powell.
Well, I tell you, she was, first of all, the woman at Motown who taught us etiquette. We were already singing, already felt good about ourselves, but she showed us how to really be graceful, elegant women.
I had a mission, and I filled it.